looked over how many trips each of you have taken in your time. Commissioner Svinicki, 17 international trips to 23 countries. Commissioner Magwood, 127 days on international travel since 2010. And I know that Chairman McFarland has requested that all five commissioners be in town at least 1 week each month in order to ensure that the commission can meet to conduct its business and be available to testify before Congress. So I'm asking if each of you would agree to her request, starting with Ms. Finnegan.
Yes, I think we work very collegially on scheduling matters, and
I'm asking if you agree with her request that you be in town 1 week a month, all of you together.
Yes, I don't think there's any month where I haven't been.
Yes.
Thank you. 1 week.
Yes, yes.
That's good, because it will make it easier on us, because some of my colleagues are complaining that we don't have enough oversight. We're going to do more oversight. Now, the NRC travel records I received are marked, quote, non-public, which is mystifying to me, since there's no good reason to keep that information secret. The taxpayers are paying for it. Now, when we travel, we get heat sometimes. We have to show where we go and what it costs, etc. Some of you publicly disclose some of your travel and your meetings, but most of you don't. So yes or no, will each of you commit to this committee to making all of your travel and meetings publicly available going forward?
I already do make my schedule okay. Publicly available and my travel publicly
yes.
Available.
Will you do that?
Yes.
Yes.
I think I'm already doing it.
You will do it.
Yes, I currently do that. I currently make my meetings public.
Okay, well, my understanding is Commissioner Biden had it in the past. So we look forward to seeing that in the future. I'm going to be introducing legislation that will ensure that the commission and staff are more open about their travel. Chairman McFarland, I think we all agree NRC must be independent. It's essential. And I'm concerned that your independence may have been compromised as you considered a request by SoCal Edison to restart the San Onofre nuclear reactor. That reactor shut down in early 2012 when its steam generators were found to be in very bad shape. The NRC properly requested considerable amount of technical information from the licensee in order to inform its decision on whether the reactor was safe. You were right to do that. But documents I have received, at least I've received some, indicate the NRC staff was preparing a document declaring the restart of the reactor, that saying that the restart of the reactor was safe months before it received all of the responses to the technical questions. So how can we have confidence in NRC's independence when it was preparing to grant industry's request months before it received the necessary safety-related information?
During the investigation of the steam generator failure at the San Onofre nuclear generating station, there were many concurrent issues that were working at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. It was a very complicated proceeding, and there was an active investigation.
Well, I'm just asking a specific question.
Mm-hmm.
Documents show that that you were ready to allow that plant to start up before all the technical studies were done, and you had something drafted. I mean, I'm just concerned. And I guess what I'm getting at, you closed, that reactor is down, it's gone. Thank God, because of the problem. Well, the company actually did it, you didn't. But the bottom line is, what I want to make sure of in the future, if there's an investigation going on, you shouldn't reopen. So I guess my question is, do you think it's right to reopen a facility while an investigation is still going on? You don't really know what the problem is.
It depends on the particular situation. Unfortunately, I can't give you a specific answer because it depends on the particular situation. And in some situations, our regulations allow for a plant to restart while an investigation
okay.
continues.
Okay, fair enough. So I'm going to just continue to work on this in my investigation. Chairman McFarland, are these statements accurate? One, NRC's former senior resident inspector for Diablo Canyon filed a formal dissent saying that Diablo was operating outside the seismic requirements of its license. Is that accurate?
I believe that the senior resident in years past did file a non-concurrence.
You believe that is correct, then?
I believe that's correct.
Second, he also said that PG&E's own analysis showed that the newly discovered faults could cause ground shaking that was 70% stronger than the NRC license allows. Is that correct?
I would have to look.
Would you get back to me on that and let me know?
Take that for the record.
Okay. I have a number of other questions I want to ask about that for the record, so I'll ask all those. Madam Chairman, recently the NRC voted to delay a recommendation by its own staff that two people be present whenever highly enriched uranium or plutonium were being handled in order to protect against an insider threat. The Department of Energy has had a rule like that in place for decades, and in 2011, the Department of Homeland Security warned that violent extremists have obtained insider positions at utilities and that, quote, insiders and their actions pose a significant threat to the infrastructure and information systems of U.S. facilities. So I'd like you to answer, do you support the quick adoption of the two-person security rule that your own staff recommended?
The commission decided not to go forward with that at this time.
Why?
It was a commission decision.
Why? What was the vote?
I'm not sure. I don't recall what the vote was.
Does anyone recall what the vote was? Not to go forward with this? And none of you remember. Yes, sir.
Madam Chair, the specific issue was that the staff had not completed a cost-benefit analysis to assess whether or not the two-person rule was appropriate.
Well, could I just say...
We don't have an answer to what the vote was. Could you tell me what the vote was?
I don't recall what the vote was. I voted.
Is anybody, five people is not a lot of people. What was it, 3-2, 4-1?
I voted against the rule because of the two-person piece.
Okay. How did you vote on it?
So, recall, I voted against.
How did you vote on it? How did you vote?
I believe I voted against it.
How did you vote?
I don't recall right now either.
I am completely flummoxed. This is a big and important issue. And this business of a cost-benefit analysis, when you're dealing with a potential terror attack and a takeover of a nuclear plant, you've got to be kidding. Now, let me say, you've never done a cost-benefit analysis for these sorts of materials tracking in the past. And you found the costs were minimal, less than $1 million a year. And I'd say the benefit of preventing someone from stealing nuclear weapons material is pretty much priceless. And I would suggest, if you don't move and reverse yourselves on this, there will be legislation. And I thank you, and I turn to my colleague.
You know, I think oftentimes in government and in Washington in particular, we become very process-oriented and lose the forest for the trees. So I'm just going to suggest a question, not to be answered here, but suggest a question for all of us to think about. Senator Sessions went through the rash of shutdowns very recently. Kewaunee in Wisconsin, Vermont Yankee, Crystal River Unit 3 in Florida, Songs 2 and 3 in California. Duke Energy announced it wouldn't move forward with Levy County, Florida. TVA announced that it would scale back work at Belafonte. Now, if any of us as individuals think most or all of those sites were unsafe or not safe enough, well, that's a good result. But if we think, as I do, that most, probably all of those sites were safe enough, that is a fundamental failure on the part of all of us, NRC, Congress, the whole establishment. So I just want to try to have us focus on the forest and not lose sight of it.